Welcome to Hope Sabbath School, an in-depth interactive study of the Word of God. I'm glad you joined us today as we continue a wonderful series of studies on the Gospel of Matthew. Our topic today, Jesus' last days before his crucifixion. And we're praying that God would speak his truth to us in life-changing ways today. We're glad you joined us. And welcome to the team. What a great series this has been. Amen. And we're just so happy that we can focus in on the life, the teachings, and the saving work of Jesus today as we talk about the last days before his crucifixion. We're always happy to hear from you, our Hope Sabbath School members around the world. And here are just a few emails we've received recently. You can write to us at sshope@hopetv.org. And William writes from Kenya and says, I want to thank our Almighty God for enabling you to share this interactive study discussion with us. Indeed, it's been a blessing to me personally and allows me to continue to pray for you. Amen. Well, we're glad you're praying for us, William. He says, may God bless you in his vineyard. You're from Mombasa there in Kenya. We're glad that you're sharing the word of God that you're learning with those around you. Also from the great continent of Africa, Thokozani, did I say that right, from Malawi. Thokozani says, I am blessed when I watch Hope Sabbath School. I hope to get more understanding of God's word through this program. That's what we're here for, right? Yeah. More understanding of the word of God. Thokozani, thanks for writing to us from the beautiful country of Malawi there in the heart of Africa. Here's one from Tennessee in the United States. And Lanny writes and says, I'm older and not as active as I once was. If you only knew what Hope Sabbath School does for me each week in my Bible study, you would all praise God once again just for me. Amen. Well, Lanny, you said you're older. We don't know how old, but we're just praising God that you're staying close to Jesus. And my prayer is you always would stay close to him. Hope Sabbath School program is so wonderful. It helps me and people all around the earth. He says it is a sure sign that we're in the last days. Well, I know that Jesus said the gospel is going to go to the whole world. And we pray that Hope Sabbath School can be a little part of the answer to that command and prayer of Jesus. Thanks for writing to us, Lanny. Here's another note from Patricia, a Zambian living in the UK. We are an international group. She says, I'm living in Colchester, but I have a home in Zambia. I had a baby prematurely in Zambia that weighed only 1 kilo at birth. That's a little baby, right? From that time, I've not been able to attend church regularly due to my baby, Bupe, which means gift. Bupe, being in and out of the hospital. She's a miracle baby. God is still at work in her life. Although I can't interact with you, I just want to thank you that I don't feel left out with an in-depth study of the Word of God. Amen? Amen. You know, folks answer the questions that we ask. They turn to the Bible text. We're glad that you're participating with us, Patricia, and we will pray for your precious little girl, Bupe. Maybe someday you can send us a picture of your family. One last note from Anessa in Guyana. Now, we do have one of our team, Ulrich, from Guyana. She says, I'm 19 years old. I write to you from the tropical country of Guyana. Hope Sabbath School has been such a blessing to me. Amen. That's interesting. We've had Lanny, right? He says, I'm older. We've got Anessa here. She's a teenager. It gives me new hope and strength to go on each time I watch. I came across Hope Sabbath School early last year. Since then, I can't help but watch and be blessed. I really enjoy singing along with the scripture songs. Each promise touches my heart. I pray that God blesses you as you share his word. Well, Anessa, we have a theme song from Psalm 148 that we've been singing for this series on the Gospel of Matthew. And the song is called Praise Him in the Heights. And we've got something special for all of our Hope Sabbath School members today. Some of you have said, why doesn't your wife ever come and say hello? She writes the scripture song. So I pled with my wife. Now, that's a little difficult because she's also the executive producer of Hope Sabbath School. So she actually tells me what to do. But I pled with her and she said she would come and sing with us. So you will get to enjoy a 3,000-year-old song with a new tune, Praise Him in the Heights. Let's sing it together. Well, thanks for singing with us, Bodil, and we're going to pray now and ask for God's blessing. And you know, we want to praise God in our study today. Amen?
Amen.
Because Jesus came to save us. We're going to study about the last days before the crucifixion. Let's pray together. Our Father in heaven, thank you so much that we can study your word today. We thank you that you have given us your word to be a lamp to our feet and a light to our path. Thank you for inspiring a former tax collector, Levi Matthew, to write an inspired account of the life and teachings of Jesus. As we study the last days of Jesus before his crucifixion, please speak to our hearts today, each Hope Sabbath School member around the world, we pray, in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Well, thanks for joining us for the song, Bodil. And let's open our Bibles now to Matthew chapter 26. And I'm wondering if, Missy, you'd begin our study today. In Matthew 26, the setting for an anointing in the little town of Bethany. Matthew 26, verses 1 through 5.
I'm reading from the New International Version. When Jesus had finished saying all these things, he said to his disciples, "As you know, the Passover is 2 days away, and the Son of Man will be handed over to be crucified. Then the chief priests and the elders of the people assembled in the palace of the high priest, whose name was Caiaphas, and they schemed to arrest Jesus secretly and kill him. But not during the festival, they said, or there may be a riot among the people."
So what's the setting? We're about to read about a very sacred act of devotion. What's the setting, Mario?
It's almost time for Passover. And the chief priests and everyone are just trying to find a way to get at Jesus.
Now, they're not thinking about Passover. They're just thinking about getting rid of
right,
Jesus.
Right.
And yet, in the huge scheme of prophecy, there's a correlation, isn't there?
Yes.
Between the Passover, where the lamb will be slain, and Jesus laying down his life. But would you describe the setting as hostile?
Yes. Yeah.
Hostile. And now we come to this beautiful service, Matthew chapter 26, beginning with verse 6. And Nicole, if you could continue reading for us, verses 6 through 13, and I have some questions about the story.
Okay. So I'm reading Matthew 26, verses 6 through 13, and I'm reading from the New King James Version. And it says, "And when Jesus was in Bethany at the house of Simon the leper, a woman came to him having an alabaster flask of very costly fragrant oil, and she poured it on his head, and he sat at the table. But when his disciples saw it, they were indignant, saying, 'Why this waste? For this fragrant oil might have been sold for much and given to the poor.' But when Jesus was aware of it, he said to them, 'Why do you trouble the woman? For she has done a good work for me. For you have the poor with you always, but me you do not have always. For in pouring this fragrant oil on my body, she did it for my burial. Assuredly, I say to you, wherever this gospel is preached in the whole world, what this woman has done will be also told as a memorial to her.'"
Now, Bethany was where? How far was that from Jerusalem? Does anybody know?
Not far.
Close. All right. A couple of kilometers maybe, right? So, in fact, the scriptures tell us in one text the proximity in stadia, but I think a couple of kilometers. It was walking distance. Now, one of the gospel writers tells us who this woman was. Does anybody know who it was?
Mary.
It was Mary, that's right. In fact, Martha was serving. Now, so when you read that account, you wonder if it's their house, but apparently it's the house of someone named Simon. At least that's what it says here, who at one point had been what?
A leper.
So it's interesting because he obviously wasn't a leper anymore. Otherwise, they wouldn't have gone to his house. So between the lines, what do you read in this story? Nathan?
Seems like he may be honoring Jesus because Jesus healed him of leprosy. So he's having this feast to celebrate and honor him.
Yeah, something very special here. He's saying thank you in a way, but someone's going to come and say thank you in a different way. So talk to me about this anointing of Jesus. What was the significance, Mario? What was that? What did it mean?
Well, the story gives indication that not everyone knew what it meant, but it also gives indication that Mary had some type of understanding or inspiration. And so the Bible says that she's coming to anoint him for burial.
That's what Jesus describes it. Did she know that? What do you think, Gloria? Do you think she knew that?
I don't think she knew that.
Okay, so she's led by the Spirit to bring this costly ointment, but it was not only sweet smelling, but it was used at the time of someone's death. But Jesus gives significance to it, doesn't he? He actually says, "She did it for my
burial."
For my burial. So here's this, what's the reaction of the people present?
This is a waste.
Yeah.
Why would you waste something so expensive?
And how does Jesus respond? Anybody?
It's not a waste.
He defends her.
It isn't a waste. Why? Why isn't it a waste, Nicole?
Because it's she's honoring me in a sense, and she's actually preparing me for and giving me encouragement, I would think, for my next step, which is going to be my burial.
And perhaps Jesus thought to himself, Mary doesn't understand all of the significance, at least not right now, of what she's doing. But later, she will understand. In fact, all of my followers down through the ages will understand, right? She was led by the Spirit. Missy?
I don't exactly know the actual worth of this flask of perfume. I know it wasn't just a $50 bottle of perfume. It was far, far more costly. Several days' wages, if not months. Is it a year's wages?
Oh,
a year's wages. Okay, so this is, I don't think we have anything today that can compare to that. But her act of devotion was, she was just pouring out her love to him in gratitude for being forgiven. And that's significant.
John 12, which is the other one that says it was Mary, mentions that someone is particularly critical. And his name was?
Judas.
It was Judas, and it wasn't just because he didn't think what she did was right. John actually tells us what was going on in Judas's head. Do you remember?
Yeah.
Kenneth?
He said because he's a thief, and he'd been stealing from Jesus' treasury. So for him thinking like, oh, this is a waste, he should have sold it so that we use it to help the poor. That wasn't his main purpose.
So, and by the way, John writes his gospel many decades later. So he didn't know at the time it was happening, but later he realizes Judas just wanted to steal that money, sell it, and I will distribute it to the poor. But actually, he was stealing from the purse himself. But let's think about today. Let's get practical here. That someone said that the act of devotion was very encouraging for Jesus, right? Okay, so what could we do for Jesus today? I mean, he's now in heaven, you know, at the right hand of the Father, right? He's died, rose again, ascended. He's coming back soon in glory. Andrea, what could we do for Jesus today that would bless his heart? Any ideas?
Well, I'm really overwhelmed just at the thought of this woman's experience and what she has given to Jesus. And just the symbolic act is so telling. I'm trying to envision how this could have played out, but I imagine that even people who were sitting at the back of this party at behind the tables and did not see what was happening, all of them smelled the fragrant aroma of the oil, of the ointment. And that is very significant to me in today's day and age, because although I cannot probably do something that will be very explicit and outwardly showing, perhaps it may be a simple act of kindness that we can do for someone else that may be so meaningful to that person. And it's not about the external show, it's about that inwardly felt experience of how the perfume has pervaded the entire room, that our light can also reflect Christ's love. That is the focus.
Beautiful.
That Christ's love be shown.
And in some ways that would be indirect, but Jesus said if you do it to one of the least, it's like doing it for me. But now I know you're a musician, right? So would it be possible to say, to go to the piano or to the organ and say, Jesus, I'm just going to play this for you? Or even at church, if you're asked to, or to preach, Mario, say, Lord, I'm going to share with them, but really I'm sharing this for you. Could that act of devotion bring joy to the heart of Jesus? Yes. What do you think, Marcus?
It could definitely bring joy to the heart of Jesus. Any way that you can serve and you can serve others is like a sweet fragrance to him, almost like the ointment that Mary had put on his feet. And really what it comes down to is cherishing and being kind to people when they're alive, right? It was for his burial, but he had not died yet. So many times we would like to say things to people at their funerals, right? We will say all the nicest things to someone when they're gone and they can't hear. But Christ wants us to be kind and to tell people that they mean something to us while they're alive.
So we're talking indirect, and that's good. We can show kindness to others. Are there any other direct ways that we could show devotion to Jesus? Jonathan.
I don't know if it's direct, but I mean, just it strikes me that the way she valued things was different than the way everyone else. Everyone else was counting dollars, and she was counting relationships, counting her love to God. So I guess any time that we can take our lives and say, okay, what is truly of value with my relationship with God, not so much about, okay, I need to make this much money, make that, and when we make those choices.
Could it be as simple, and I'll come to your point, Gloria, could it be as simple as saying, I love you, Jesus? I mean, I wonder how many people there are who profess to be Christians who've gone days, weeks, or even months without saying, I love you, Jesus. Thank you for being my Savior.
Amen. Yes.
Is that too simple? Yeah. Is that an act of devotion, Gloria?
I really admire her boldness, because Jesus was in a party or with somebody having a moment with Simon the leper, but she went there to express her gratitude. And sometimes we feel like we need to reach a certain point, or we have to be in a certain behavior or mood to express our gratitude to God. But she knew what God had done for her, and then she went in to the crowd, not ignoring all that people would think of her, and then just gave her worship to God.
You know, someone told me one time, it's more important what Jesus thinks of you than what people think. We need to move on to another text. And Lavinia, if you could continue reading for us in Matthew chapter 26. We're now in verses 17 through 25. And the setting here is the Passover. And let's look at the setting, and then someone's going to read where Jesus institutes this sacred service, which we call the Lord's Supper.
Sure. I'm reading from the New King James Version, and it reads, "Now on the first day of the Feast of Unleavened Bread, the disciples came to Jesus, saying to him, 'Where do you want us to prepare for you to eat the Passover?' And he said, 'Go into the city to a certain man and say to him, "The teacher says, my time is at hand. I will keep the Passover at your house with my disciples." So the disciples did as Jesus had directed them, and they prepared the Passover. When evening had come, he sat down with the 12. Now, as they were eating, he said, "Assuredly, I say to you, one of you will betray me." And they were exceedingly sorrowful, and each of them began to say to him, "Lord, is it I?" He answered and said, "He who dipped his hand with me in the dish will betray me. The Son of Man indeed goes just as it is written of him, but woe to that man by whom the Son of Man is betrayed. It would have been good for that man if he had not been born." Then Judas, who was betraying him, answered and said, "Rabbi, is it I?" He said to him, "You have said it."
Wow, we're at the Passover. Jesus has a heavy heart. What makes his heart heavy is that he's going to have to bear the sin of the world, or that one of his followers is going to betray him.
All of it,
right? And yet, somehow, he's got a special gift to give to us. And Andre, if you could continue reading, and then I want us to ask, why does Jesus give this service at this time? If you could read for us verses 26 through 30 of Matthew 26, we'll learn about the Lord's Supper.
Absolutely. I'm reading from the New King James Version. And it says, "As they were eating, Jesus took bread, blessed it, and broke it, and gave it to the disciples and said, 'Take, eat, this is my body.' Then he took the cup and gave thanks and gave it to them, saying, 'Drink from it, all of you, for this is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for many for the remissions of sin. But I say to you, I will not drink of this fruit of the vine from now on until that day when I drink it new with you in my Father's kingdom.' And when they had sung a hymn, they went out to the Mount of Olives."
Now, Jesus had been with them for several years, right? His ministry spanned more than 3 years. Why do you think he waited to this time, and specifically time of Passover, to institute this service? Nathan, is the timing significant?
Absolutely, because he was all of the animals that had been sacrificed. We always say lamb, it was sheep, rams, goats could be used, but all the sacrificial animals up until that point were pointing forward to his death. Mm-hmm. And now he was about to give his life, and so it was critical for them to have a new symbol. He says, this is the blood of the covenant, and this new covenant experience that he's arranging for them to understand, he is the Passover lamb. He is the one who would be sacrificed.
So the bitter herbs and the lamb itself, they don't have that. They just take the unleavened bread and the unfermented wine as symbols of the broken body and shed blood of Jesus. Now that is, I think, one of the most sacred services of the Christian church. Mm-hmm. You've got baptism, that's important, right? Certainly conversion when you say, Jesus, be my Savior. But communion too. Now, I have a question for you. I had a student some years ago say to me, I don't go to the Lord's Supper because I don't feel worthy. Where did she get that from? Some people have that misunderstanding. I don't feel worthy. Nathan, where did she get that from?
Paul does speak about to the Corinthian church about some who have eaten the Lord's Supper in an unworthy manner, but he's not addressing it in none of us are worthy in the sense that, you know, who can say, oh, I'm worthy in God's presence, but that's why we come, right? So we come with a contrite heart and saying, Lord, because of my unworthiness, I'm coming to accept your gift. When Paul speaks about them coming in an unworthy manner, eating and drinking in an unworthy manner, he's talking about those who come without the sense of what this sacred symbol means.
So carelessly, if I come realizing I'm a sinner, isn't that how I'm supposed to come?
Yes.
So worthy is the Lamb, not worthy is me, right, Andrea?
Perhaps it really helps to see the first part of the story, who really came as unworthy to the Lord's Supper. We see that Judas was not right with Jesus. He harbored resentment and hatred and wanted to betray Jesus. He was truly the unworthy one. And I think if we would help this person understand that coming as unworthy people is natural. All of us are unworthy. However, we also need to go through some steps and overcome whatever feelings of guilt that we may be struggling with. We need to make things right with people and with God before partaking of the
Lord's Supper. So we take it seriously.
Yeah.
We confess our sins, but none of us is worthy to partake of the symbols of the broken body and shed blood of Jesus. And you know, that's what I told this young lady. And I saw her some months later, and she said, I went to the communion, and it was a wonderful blessing. Amen?
Amen.
Right, because that's who it's for. It's for us, but not to be careless. And that's interesting, Andrea, you pointed out that even in that group, I mean, look at Peter and James and John squabbling over who'll be the greatest, you know, but they repented. But you've got the example of one whose heart is resistant, and that certainly is coming in an unworthy manner. I have several hands raised. Let me start with Nathan, Mario, and Andrea.
Just sharing an experience of someone who had experienced the blessing of the communion service. Several years ago when I was pastoring an Adventist church, we combined our weekend services on Easter weekend with a church that was renting from us on Sundays. And so we invited them to worship with us on Saturday before their Easter Sunday service. And they came, several of the members came to our church, and they'd never experienced the foot washing service. We practiced foot washing, which is something we see from John 13. And one of the couples broke down. There was a husband and wife washing each other's feet, and they were in tears during the service. And when they were asked, is everything okay? They explained that on the way to church that morning, they'd had a horrible argument, terrible fight, you know, and that can happen. And you show up at church and you put your smile on your face, but inwardly, they were burning with anger toward each other. And I invited them, the congregation, to enter into the foot washing service with someone that perhaps they needed to make an apology to or make things right. And when they did that, they experienced freedom and peace.
Beautiful.
And then they could go into the communion service with the right spirit instead of with anger toward each other. Mm-hmm. So that's a beautiful thing that Jesus gave us, the opportunity to.
It really is. And did you notice that phrase? I don't know, share with me if you've ever thought about this when you share in this service, but Jesus says, I won't share this with you again until I do so in my Father's kingdom. Mm-hmm. Has anybody thought about that when you were sharing this sacred service? What's that going to be like? Have you imagined in my Father's kingdom? Anybody? Mm. What do you think? Marcus?
It's going to be just an awesome experience. It's going to be exhilarating. It's going to be joyful. It's also going to be, have some seriousness to it as well, because we realize the immense sacrifice that Christ gave on the cross for us.
So we'll be smiling and crying at the same time? Is that possible?
Yes.
Smiling or crying, you know, inexpressible joy, right? Yeah. Kenneth.
First of all, having the opportunity to sit in God's kingdom and then, let's say, have this service with him is so precious. And also, coming from a culture where funeral is very important, I see this memorial service as the funeral service of the Son of God. Mm. So imagine if you refuse to come to God's son's funeral, what do you want God to say to you after he has given that son to you as a gift?
So, and that's interesting. You're speaking from the Ghanaian culture. Yeah. So coming to that service, the funeral and the activities surrounding it, is that a sign of respect?
Yes, it's a sign of respect. It also tells you that you care about the person and you are together with that person.
That's a new insight, isn't it?
Yeah. Yeah.
That we don't just come to the communion for us, but we come for him, right? The story continues to unfold. Jonathan, if you take a look as we continue in Matthew 26, verses 36 to 46 records the anguish of Jesus in Gethsemane, a garden just across the Kidron Valley from Jerusalem.
All right, I'll be reading from the New Living Translation. Then Jesus went with them to the olive grove called Gethsemane, and he said, "Sit here while I go over to there to pray." He took Peter and Zebedee's two sons, James and John, and he became anguished and distressed. He told them, "My soul is crushed with grief to the point of death. Stay here and keep watch with me." Then he went on a little further and bowed with his face to the ground, praying, "My Father, if it is possible, let this cup of suffering be taken away from me. Yet I want your will to be done, not mine." Then he returned to the disciples and found them asleep. He said to Peter, "Couldn't you watch with me even 1 hour? Keep watch and pray so that you will not give in to temptation. For the spirit is willing, but the body is weak." Then Jesus left them a second time and prayed, "My Father, if this cup cannot be taken away unless I drink it, your will be done." When he returned to them again, he found them sleeping, for they couldn't keep their eyes open. So he went to pray a third time, saying the same things again. Then he came to the disciples and said, "Go ahead and sleep. Have your rest. But look, the time has come. The Son of Man is betrayed into the hands of sinners. Up, let's be going. Look, my betrayer is here."
Why was this experience in Gethsemane so difficult for Jesus, Sean? What do you think?
It really had to do with the separation he was going to face. You know, him not being able to be with the Father because he had to take on all our sin, our guilt, our shame. That's agonizing. I can't even fathom how, you know, difficult that was. But obviously we see he said, you know, "This is crushing my soul."
Wow, that's a powerful expression, crushing my soul. We'll later hear him cry out, my God," right?
Yeah.
"Why have you forsaken me?" So anybody want to add to that? Why is this so difficult? Missy?
I just wanted to add that this is where the fate of humanity kind of was
hanging in the balance.
Hanging in the balance. Had he chosen not to go through with it, it would have been over. But he wrestled with his own will and chose to surrender it to God. And thank God, this is the crux of our faith.
Amen. Yeah. Amen. You know, I'm thinking of a previous study. We have a choice, right?
Yeah.
And Jesus had a choice. And what did he choose?
He
chose God's way.
Not my will, but thine.
Not my will, but your will be done. Jonathan?
Yeah, I think it's also that he was just worried. Like, there was so much that rested on him walking moment by moment in God's will so that he was a correct testimony. I mean, he's going to go through, all these people are going to be attacking him and all these different things. Yes, I think that the pain and stuff certainly was part of it, but if you look at Christ, I think he was really most concerned about, "Father, this, if I mess this up, what it will do to your kingdom, to my testimony, all these things that I am here to do, it just, I have to testify."
Undoubtedly, he's not just thinking about his own well-being, but the whole plan. Yes, Andre.
And we also see a glimpse of his humanity because talking about the separation, the feeling of separation, but also when he says to his disciple, He says, you know, couldn't you wait up with me for a while? You know, here's a sense of rejection that Jesus is starting to feel.
And certainly a need for support, right?
Yeah,
right.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Yes, Mario.
You know, we don't have to go to the text, but for those listening, you can look it up. It's Luke 9:51. And in that text, it just says that that Jesus was steadfast, or set his face steadfast to Jerusalem to be offered up. And you see him so confident, seemingly, about his destiny. But then in Gethsemane, you see his humanity, like Andre was saying, coming out, and it's like, wow, that's what I go through sometimes. You know, I know that I have some things that I have to do, but sometimes fear or you know, comes over me. And it's just good to see that Jesus is, you know, kind of like I am, but at the same time, he's my example because he says, I'm going to do what I have to do. So that was encouraging.
You know, this is such a powerful, I'm going to share a quotation from one of my favorite books on the life of Jesus, The Desire of Ages. And there it says, it would be well for us to spend a thoughtful hour each day contemplating the life of Christ. Well, that's what we're doing in this series on the Gospel of Matthew, right? But it says we should take it scene by scene, especially the closing ones. So I have a question for you. I know several other hands are raised, so I'm sure your comment may fit in here. What lessons could we learn by contemplating what Jesus is going through here in Gethsemane? And I've got seven hands raised, I think. Let's start here in the front. Nathan, what lesson could we learn?
Mario brought up an excellent point, and that is that Jesus made his decision and set his face toward Jerusalem, which he knew.
Beforehand, right?
Yeah, and he knew that that meant death on the cross for him. And in my estimation, this was the hardest part of Jesus' experience. Gethsemane was more difficult than the cross, in the sense that that's where he struggled with the decision. Once the decision was made, not that the cross was easy, that was terribly excruciating, where he was literally separated from the Father's presence, and he cried out, quoting Psalm 22:1, right, my God, why have you abandoned me or forsaken me? But he could go through that because he'd already done the hard work in prayer beforehand. So the lesson for us, I believe, is the hardest part of being a Christian is choosing to do God's will and surrendering your own will to his. Wow. When you have struggled and made that decision, that terrible battle against self-will, if you've been victorious in that, the rest will fall into line and God will give you victory.
And that's a miracle too, isn't it? That's a gift of God. I think of that little song, I Have Decided.
Follow Jesus.
Right, Nicole?
Well, the Bible talks about being forsaken. And I think that something we can learn from this lesson is that their friends are going to forsake you. You're going to have family forsake you. You have people who are not going to be able to keep up with the things that you're trying to do when it comes to serving Christ. But we know that God will never forsake us, and he'll always be there for us. So it's like Jesus knew that, and he kept calling on his Father to help him. I think we need to realize that even if the friends and the family around us are not for us, we know who is for us, and that would be Christ.
And you know, someone pointed out to me, just really impressed me, that even though he felt forsaken, he's still praying to his Father.
Yep. Yeah.
My God, right? So he's not abandoning that connection. Right. He's just feeling the weight of that sin. I don't know whose hand was next, but Marcus.
Well, the prayer was just such an important thing, and that unfortunately the disciples were very much caught off guard when the actual soldiers came. And that was because they didn't spend the time with Christ in prayer as well. And so that's going to be for many people who think that they have a connection with Christ in the last days, right? Because they will come to this analysis paralysis, if you will, as well, because they will not have spent that time in connection and in prayer with Christ. When the crisis comes, and it will, they will be caught in that same paralysis as well, because they didn't spend that time in connection with prayer.
And we're going to come to that later in our study when we talk about Peter and the denial. But I want us to move on now to Judas, because there's some lessons here. Maybe part of the anguish Jesus experienced was the choices that Judas was making. Before we read the actual betrayal, someone read verses 14 through 16. I'm wondering, Gloria, could you read that for us?
Sure.
Verses 14 through 16 of Matthew 26. This is a premeditated betrayal. How does it read in your Bible?
I'm reading from the New King James Version. It says, "Then one of the 12, called Judas Iscariot, went to the chief priests and said, "What are you willing to give me if I deliver him to you?" And they counted out to him 30 pieces of silver. So from that time, he sought opportunity to betray him.
So I have a question for you. And then, John, I'd like you to read the next actual betrayal section. Do you think that Judas thought that they were going to actually kill Jesus? No. They wanted to kill him, right? He knew that. Do you think he thought they actually would?
No. I think he thought that Jesus would escape. He had seen Jesus escape in the past when they had tried to, you know, he would slip through the crowd when they wanted to attack him or hope to stone him. And I think he was just thinking he's going to force Jesus' hand here so that Jesus would have to miraculously escape.
It's kind of like the sin of presumption with the, you know, jump off the temple, kind of forcing God's hand. Sean, I'd like you to read on for us in Matthew 26, 47 to 50, and let's see how this planned betrayal unfolds.
Okay, I'm reading from the New King James Version. "And while he was still speaking, behold, Judas, one of the 12, came with a great multitude with swords and clubs, came from the chief priests and elders of people. And, now his betrayer had given them a sign, saying, 'Whomever I kiss, he is the one, seize him.' Immediately he went up to Jesus and said, 'Greetings, Rabbi,' and kissed him. But Jesus said to him, 'Friend, why have you come?' And then they came and laid hands on Jesus and took him."
Now, how could Judas do such a terrible thing? Kenneth, help. I don't know that we can ever fully understand what's going on in someone's mind, but to actually come up and kiss Jesus and then hear Jesus call him friend?
From the Bible, you know, we earlier on read about Judas stealing from their treasury. And I believe Satan was thinking along the line, because Satan was somehow looking for someone he can use to hand Jesus over. And because Judas did not fully let go of this sin, it prepared him for the time that he could find himself in a state where he would betray his Lord.
Would you say that he's out of control at this point? Mm-hmm. What do you think, Andre?
I would say when you look at the political arena and when people are running campaigns, you have these people behind the scenes that are doing things, some trickery and other things, smear campaigns, different things like that,
yes,
in order to push their candidate forward. And so sometimes they'll work with the other side, unbeknownst to, you know, not, it's not publicly, but they'll work with the other side in order to work a plan. And so I'm looking at Judas and I'm saying he wasn't an idiot. He knew exactly what he was doing. He went to the chief priest and he said, "What would you give me if I turn him over to you?"
Yes.
And it's like he's laying out this plan, thinking that this, and someone said it earlier, that this would spur Jesus on to take his rightful place and do what he came to do, not realizing that Jesus, humble, was following the plan of the Father instead.
Let's look at one other text, and then I'll come to the two points here on the front. Mario, could you read Luke 22 and verse 3? We're asking, how could he do such a thing? And you're saying, well, it was premeditated, but could we end up doing things that we could never imagine ourselves doing?
Yes.
I mean, is it possible to walk down a road and say, I never thought I would do this? Luke 22 and verse 3, Mario.
So I'll be reading from the New King James Version. And Luke 22 verse 3 says, "Then Satan entered Judas, surnamed Iscariot, who was numbered among the 12.
So now that raises a whole other question. I don't know if it relates to the raised hands, but how is Satan able to enter a person? Andrea?
I believe it happens by very small steps. And the path of complacency is very steep. And sometimes we think it's really not going to take us all the way down. But we know from the Bible that we cannot serve two masters. And Judas has all along built up a love for money and a love for ambition and for pride and supremacy rather than a love for his Lord. Mm. And when the right opportunity came, like we have read, Satan entered him. It wasn't too much that he had to do, because Judas's heart was already divided.
You know, that's you've said something really important, Andrea, and that is, it's small steps that lead to destruction. There are very few people who get up and say, Satan, enter me, take full control. I've heard someone do that. A student came to me and said, I did that, and the next 5 weeks were like living hell. And then finally they said, I'm either going to die or cry out to God. And she cried out to God. Amen?
Praise God. Yeah.
Jesus saved her. But there are a few people that do that, but most don't, do they? They think they're the master of their own destiny. But I want to know how we can avoid this terrible situation ourselves. Missy.
We remember what caused Satan to fall was his selfish ambition. And that's exactly what happened to Judas. Uh-huh. It was selfish ambition. Wow. He was thinking that Jesus was going to be the ruler of the Jewish nation. And that he would be his right-hand man, you know, having a very high position.
Chief financial officer,
yes.
Right? So he could
yes.
keep stealing
yes.
from the treasury.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yes.
Matthew 27, verses 1 to 5, the story continues to unfold. Kenneth, I wonder if you could read that for us. Matthew 27, it's Judas's tragic end. And I don't have us focus on this just to be critical, but to say, how do we avoid such a disaster? Because it could happen to us, right? If we keep taking those steps away from God's will. Kenneth, Matthew 27, verses 1 to 5.
Reading from the New King James Version, it reads, when morning came, all the chief priests and elders of the people plotted against Jesus to put him to death. And when they had bound him, they led him away and delivered him to Pontius Pilate, the governor. Then Judas, his betrayer, seeing that he had been condemned, was remorseful and brought back the 30 pieces of silver to the chief priests and elders, saying, I have sinned by betraying an innocent blood. And they said, what is that to us? You see to it. Then he threw down the pieces of silver in the temple and departed and went and hanged himself.
Hmm. That is so sad. Mm-hmm. Do you hear repentance in that text? Or do you hear despair? How do you know which it is, Nathan?
I believe it's despair. And I think it's interesting that Jesus thought, as you said earlier, he could be the master of his own his own destiny. He thought he had everything under control. And I think in his mind, he was thinking, I'm playing this just right because I'm getting all this silver. And Jesus is going to come out the winner in this confrontation anyway, because he thought Jesus would defend himself. So he'd come out like a hero. It's a win-win situation. Jesus is still okay. And I just took a bunch of money from the enemies of Jesus. I think when he brings back the silver, it's like this feeble attempt to somehow undo part of what he did. Like, how can I back out of this mess? And he's desperate, and he just throws it down. Like, I want nothing to do with what happened because it didn't work out the way he planned. And it just reminds me of a text we mentioned in a previous study, a series quite a while back. But there is a way that seems right to a man, but the end thereof is death. Judas had it all figured out. And for me, it means I have to be careful that I don't think I've got it figured out. And the way that seems right to me may be wrong if I'm not surrendering my will to the Father.
So Nathan said it was despair and not repentance. What evidence do you see? And I think you're right. Mario, what evidence do you see that it is indeed despair and not repentance here?
You know, the end result was that he went and committed suicide. And individuals typically who do that feel like there's no hope. There's no way that I can turn around from whatever situation that they're in. But Judas, the hope that Judas did not have, we can see through the text that we were reading. You know, when Judas was getting ready to betray Jesus and he dipped his hand in the cup, you know, that Passover, that was there for him available as well.
Yes.
But he didn't understand the significance. And then, even now, when he's betraying Jesus, he didn't know the meaning of the sacrifice applied to him as well there. Mm. And it's just, he didn't have that relationship. He didn't have that understanding. And so therefore, he was in despair.
I know there's much more we can share, and so I want to go on and look at Peter in this last section, because Peter also denies Jesus, and Peter also is potentially suicidal, but he chooses repentance rather than despair. And I'm thinking the last words of Jesus to Judas, friend, is an invitation. Friend. Let's look in Matthew 26, first verses 31 to 35. And Lavinia, would you read that for us, 31 to 35? This is a preface to the denial. What, we have an expression in English, red flags. What warning signs do you see in this interchange between Jesus and Peter?
Okay, reading from the New King James Version. Then Jesus said to them, all of you will be made to stumble because of me this night, for it is written, I will strike the shepherd, and the sheep of the flock will be scattered. But after I have been raised, I will go before you to Galilee. Peter answered and said to him, even if all are made to stumble because of you, I will never be made to stumble. Jesus said to him, assuredly, I say to you that this night, before the rooster crows, you will deny me three times. Peter said to him, even if I have to die with you, I will not deny you. And so said all the disciples.
So what warning signs do you see that Simon Peter's at risk here? Anybody? Andre.
He's overconfident.
Yeah. Overconfident?
Self-confident.
Self-confident?
A lot of use of I.
I will, comparing himself, right, yeah. Sean?
The fact that Jesus, who had told them so many things that they have not known, said, you will be ashamed of me and all these things will happen. And he's like, no, I don't care. I'm still going to not stumble. And that's a red flag when you really go against what Jesus is
doing. So what should he have said at that point?
Help.
Help me. I don't even know how I'm going to get there. Gloria?
And I see that he's trying to rewrite what is written in the scripture. Sometimes we feel like, oh, this is what is going to happen, end times is happening. But we feel like because we are in this, things are somehow going to change for us.
That we can change it or fix it. We need to move on to verses 51 to 56. Andrea was still in Matthew 26, 51 to 56. Some kind of warning sign here that he's at risk. And I'm doing this for us so that we can learn today.
In the New King James Version, we read the following. And suddenly one of those who were with Jesus stretched out his hand and drew his sword, struck the servant of the high priest, and cut off his ear. But Jesus said to him, put your sword in its place, for all who take the sword will perish by the sword. Or do you think that I cannot now pray to my Father, and he will provide me with more than 12 legions of angels? How then could the scriptures be fulfilled, that it must happen thus? In that hour, Jesus said to the multitudes, have you come out as against a robber with swords and clubs to take me? I sat daily with you, teaching in the temple, and you did not seize me. But all this was done that the scriptures of the prophets might be fulfilled. Then all the disciples forsook him and fled.
What other warning signs do you see in this passage that particularly Simon Peter, but maybe all of the disciples are at risk? Anybody? Nicole?
He tried to take matters into his own hands instead of relying on the Father. And it shows also a level of lack of understanding as to what really was going to be happening. So
now, Matthew says it's one of the disciples, but you're inferring that it was Peter that took the sword out. Is that right?
Yes.
Because John 18 tells us that, right?
Yes.
John says, this is who it was. So again, I'm fighting. I've got a plan. Like Gloria said, I'm going to make this work. What was the other indication that things are going wrong? Right at the end of the passage.
They all forsook him and fled.
Right? And so this is the scenario. Now, we're not going to read Matthew 26, 69 to 75, but it's the denial. And he ends up with cursing, saying what?
I don't know this.
I don't know this.
I don't even know who this is. And then it says that he went out and wept bitterly. So want to focus on Jesus and not just the failing, but what's the lesson that we have to learn as we look at this scenario, Marcus?
It's not good to go with the crowd. Basically, Peter was trying to go with the crowd. He came in with the multitude as they were trying Jesus. And so he wanted to fit in. So when the young girl said, that man was with Jesus, he's like, no, that wasn't me. Then he says it again, she says it again, and all the eyes turn to Peter. And he says, no, again, it's not me. But he had such good speech, like what Jesus had, that he had to curse to make himself not look like he was a part of mm-hmm. Jesus' discipleship. Yeah. And that's why it's a slippery slope to follow the crowd, because so, you do anything.
So the that, negative is don't follow the crowd, but let me get the positive in closing. Nathan, help us with the positive, because Peter doesn't go and hang himself. He could have, right? He was a fisherman. He knew how to use ropes. So what does he see that gives him hope even when he's really made a terrible mistake?
I think when we read elsewhere where Jesus looked at him with love, you know, that when he betrayed Jesus and the cock crowed, and he knew that it's still Jesus loved him, and he knew he could come back to him. Of course, later we see after the resurrection that Jesus did reinstate him as a disciple.
Right at the end of the Gospel of John. Yeah. So somewhere when all hope seems lost because we did what?
We blew it.
the American expression, we messed up, we blew it, we betrayed Jesus. There is hope if we'll do what?
If we come back to him.
It's back to what you said, Andrea, that, you know, are we going to run to Jesus and repent, right? That's the preparation for the communion. We're out of time, but we're going to come back in our next study and look at the death and resurrection of Jesus, because Jesus died so that you don't have to suffer for your sin. Jesus conquered death for you. He is your Savior. We'll discover that beautiful truth as we continue in the Gospel of Matthew. But I just pray that we would not try to run our own lives, even thinking we're helping God, but we would surrender to God, cry out to Him, and let Jesus save us. Let's pray. Father in heaven, what lessons for our lives today? Oh, whether we're coming to the communion or we're coming to you in prayer or we're doing something to show our devotion to you, may our hearts be fully open to you and receive your mercy and your grace, your salvation. Oh, Lord, may we not resist you in any way, but let you be the beautiful Savior that you are, is our prayer in your holy name. Amen.
Amen.
Well, thanks for joining us for Hope Sabbath School. I hope you'll stay with us as we conclude this series, The Gospel of Matthew, lessons to bless your life and bless the lives of those around you.